don't want to disappear in a cave. So I want to give an update here. Tremendous amount of clarity is coming up, but I'm also working on trying to forge some sort of way to enhance the outreach and the helpfulness, and just working on that and not exactly succeeding yet. Several dreams, important dreams, came up. One was a extremely intense rain that was just shocking. The intensity of the downpour, the rain, was so ferocious that I was just stunned. And it didn't last that long, about 4 minutes as it were, but going outside and looking out afterwards is just devastating. It's incredible, the amount of change that had taken place from this rain, this ferocious rain. Then last night I had a dream just before waking up where everything seemed to be resolved. I had come to a conclusion and resolved everything, and I was going forth, and someone said, "Well, how are you going to dress?" And they said, "Maybe you should dress like a lawyer, because this whole—you know—you're going to the legal system is going to—you can't help but run into that in this culture." And I woke up and I said, "Ah, it's true that we literally live in a society that is so litigious that it's really like a form of terrorism, isn't it? The legal system here and the lawyers, that everybody can promote lawsuits against everyone else for any reason, just because they want to be obstructionist or delay or something. It's a terrible system we live in, terrible system, really. It's hard to imagine a worse system, actually, even though the lawyers tell us it's hard to imagine a better system. But imagine who's in charge. Just look, don't have to imagine who's in charge. The lawyers are in charge. Almost all of the politicians are lawyers. And it's a very inbred mindset. It's a very limited mindset. The law truly does not understand salvation at all. Their understanding is a zero. It's a zero. Nothing. So how can they possibly know how to structure a truly just society? A just society is one that helps free us from insanity. And truly, we are engaged with an insane idea. So we have to free ourselves from that engagement. We're engaged with a hypothetical of what if reality were annihilated. And we need to exchange hypotheticals and engage with another hypothetical of what if reality could never be annihilated. Okay? So the society has to facilitate that. And the society has to be based on the wisdom of what our true responsibility is, how we need to spend our time, right use of time. It's not based on that at all right now. The rain that I saw, I viewed it as a REIGN, like the British Raj, rain, meaning the next 4 years in America, most likely, the rain that is to come. And that was just unbelievably intense. Unbelievably intense, thunderous. The rain came down so hard. Now my house survived it. House survived, but the roads, all the roads, I mean, were washed out. It's incredible what happened to the roads. The roads were washed out. There were gullies everywhere. Everything was changed. So we are heading into an extraordinarily intense situation that I've been warning about for so long, and it's certainly been my goal is to somehow be a better advocate once these times commence, to be a more effective, more useful, being a, I would say, an expert on depression, how to help those who want the help. You see, I got reached a point where my mind reached the point of experiencing total chaos, which is the lowest point the mind can ever possibly go. And from that point, I said, you know what, I need help, and I need the very best help there is, and I won't settle for anything less than total freedom from any possibility of reaching this point again. And so I continue on with that, and I'm relentless about it. But in doing so, I've uncovered, you know, the roots of depression. I understand it very, very well. And someday I hope to be a very, very strong advocate of how to structure society and how to help us help those who are depressed. And because there definitely is a way to get out of it, and I'm proof of that. But I have not yet succeeded in certain certitude that I'll never ever be faced with such a situation again. I know there is a way, which is exchanging hypotheticals. That's the only way. Haven't done it yet, but I'm in high pursuit of that for sure. And so I hope to be a very, very adamant advocate to speak for those who cannot speak for themselves because they're so depressed. I mean, I was in a state that was so terrible that you can't believe it. And really feeling like I had no voice, no capability to speak up. Because in this world, in existence, when you try to help existence out, first of all, existence is screaming. Spirit, aspects of spirit that are dreaming are saying, oh, we're trapped, please help us. And they had this such a painful cry of suffering and misery and fear that you want to help, this desire to help. And even though you think, well, wait a minute, I want to get free of this, you think, well, I better help. What happens is when you get pulled down into the denser levels here, you find yourself, what happens is that you try and accommodate both truth and lies, in other words, the ego and the Holy Spirit. You try to find a way to accommodate both, an integration as it were, because it seems like the quicker path, because people are suffering right now so terribly, you want something that's fast. And you don't want to say, well, you have to unlearn all the lessons that the ego has taught you. God, that seems like, oh my gosh. And I can see the intensity of this world of how people focus on the ego's plan of salvation and learn it over and over and reinforce their lessons just to an incredible extent. And they literally have to unlearn those. And it just seems like, holy cow, that is going to be so difficult for them and take so long. Whoa, is it difficult. So there's this tendency is to say, let me see, maybe there's a way to integrate it or please them both or something like that. That's what leads to the depression. And the more determination you have to help, the worse the depression gets, because you keep thinking, I'll take this all the way to the end, and maybe at the end there'll be some beautiful integral transformation will take place. Well, it doesn't. It doesn't. That's what I found out. It does not take place, which is totally shocking. I said, oh my gosh, all I'm faced with is total chaos, mental chaos, complete mental chaos, and nothing else. I said, oh boy, that's really something. And then I realized you cannot accommodate mutual exclusives. It's impossible. And so all the overlearning that the ego, that we're all engaged in this world, does have to be unlearned. You do have to relinquish it, which means it does take time, which means you do have to have a society structured on doing that. There's no magic pill. There is no magic pill. Never will be. The problem that I see with the acculturation of the present times is that it's the style. It's the style that they're learning. Even, you know, you can go to listen to truth, listen to satsang, and not get it. But what you do get is the style of presentation, the way to do the whole thing. You do get that, and that's actually a great benefit, because at some point you're going to, stuff will start filtering in, and you have the discipline. Whereas right now, like for instance, forget about the content of like television and mass media and all that, the whole cultural milieu. Forget about the content for a second. Just the style of it. Just looking at it, what I notice is the style. And everybody's getting super familiar with this style. It's a very legalistic style. It's a very confrontational style. It's a very fake, bogus style. It has nothing to do with the style you need in satsang, in inquiry, in to come out of depression. It has nothing to do with it at all. The style, the whole style is it's like a cup with holes in the bottom. You know, that's the style. You just can't use that style the way that they go about it. So people are just, what they expect is you to put your teaching into the style that they're familiar with. But the style itself, it's like asking you to fill up a cup that's got holes in the bottom. You can't do it. So it is a tremendous problem. one of the benefits of coming into this world like this and working on this problem is you realize just how bad the problems are, and you lose your naivete. And I've seen just how people will relentlessly reinforce the stylistic and ways of the ego, and also the content of the ego relentlessly. I said, wow, boy, are they trying, burying, you know, digging themselves a hole, as it were. What a hole they're digging themselves, really. Now, can they get out? Of course. But it takes a society, it takes an acculturation which is based on focusing on that task at hand. And once you do focus on it, you can make incredible progress. You really can. And there's nothing that you've learned that can't be unlearned. Nothing of the ego that is learned. All of that can be unlearned. And it can be done rather quickly, but you have to really go quickly and focus on it and be very nimble. Very dedicated, very nimble. And if stylistically you're going about the wrong way, you're just going to be stumbling over yourself all the time. And it's just the way that that mass media and entertainment is presenting everything is very, very counter to the way that you need to go about an inquiry. So that is a gigantic problem going forward that I don't know if people realize just what a severe problem that is, which is why I'm so adamant, don't watch television. Don't pay attention to the mass media. Don't pay attention to entertainment in this world. You'll dig yourself a hole, because it's based on confrontational. It's the debates, debating, confrontational. This viewpoint screaming, and then this viewpoint screaming. Just the whole way that thing presented. You can't proceed on the spiritual path that way at all. You cannot. You have to find someone who you have faith that knows who's an expert, truly an expert, and knows what they're talking about. And then you have to listen and pay attention and let it sink in and quell any attempt to be argumentative, to be disputational, to set up all sorts of false little tricks and traps, etc. No, you can't do it that way. It'll slow you down too much, and when you get slowed down, you lose heart, get dispirited. So you need a very respectful culture, respectful and trusting and faith, and you have to have a system where from childhood you have to very much focus on the right attitude to have, and the right way to keep yourself quiet and keep yourself still, and be able to have an intelligent, clear focus on what's being said, and so many other things, and to see the way that things are resolved in a society. And we're getting all the wrong examples right now. So I guess to be realistic, I have to look at whatever I'm going to do at some point, and some point I certainly will. It may be somewhere down the road, some other time, some other place, etc., having to assess just how difficult it really is and what the remedy needs to be. You can't be naive about it. And it's really the ego, you know, we really put ourselves in a deep, deep hole with trying to block any sort of progress towards getting free of disengaging, exchanging hypotheticals. The ego guides us to block that, to be afraid of it, to resist any efforts to clarify. And stylistically, the world is in a horrible place right now. Very legalistic, I call it. Always turning also towards the flesh for some resolution. Just the whole entire way that the world's going about things is into darkness, into great bondage and darkness. So really, there has to be the right approach on the macro level of how do you help? How do you help? You have to help. There, help is needed. Right examples are needed, and right preparation is needed to exchange hypothetical scenarios. But how do you bring that about? So sometime in some place, there has to be a way, and that has to be properly carried out. And it's and if you try to go about it, and you run up against this incredible resistance that's in people stylistically. They say, hey, you're not doing it stylistically the way I'm familiar with. But if you do it stylistically the way that they're familiar with, you're going to give them a mixed message, and sort of like a stalemate. Yeah, stalemate isn't good enough. It's not good enough. So it's open to question how much anyone can do at this point. It's deteriorated to such an extent. The yelling at each other is just growing like a virus, like a cancer. The raising of the voices, even on the internet, though people are not, they're texting and messaging. You can feel the voices being raised, the anger, the rage, and all this stuff. And wow, if there's someone that somebody's mad at, you know, go find someone that you're not mad at, you know, and then listen to them. Don't listen to those you're mad at. That's just going to raise your blood pressure and waste your time. And I don't mean you, the viewer here. I'm using you as the totality of the situation here. It's something to keep in mind for everyone. I'm not excluding a viewer, but I'm not trying to pin it on any viewer. No. It's the totality of the situation I'm speaking of. Try to always speak in terms of the totality of the situation here. It's brutal. It's absolutely brutal. And the rain that is coming is going to be just shockingly intense. And I experienced that in that rainstorm. Good grief. It's like, take the heaviest rainstorm, thunderstorm you've ever experienced and times 10. And the wind. I thought all the trees were going to break. I thought everything was going to be torn to pieces, really. It was so intense. And a lot of them were. It was just countryside looked like a war had taken place. Really. Maybe it will. I mean, good grief. So it's difficult to assess what's going to happen in the future. It really is, in terms of how to help people or how to keep yourself from being really knocked out. And I will give you whatever advice that I come up with. Because again, I am an extreme advocate of for the depressed, those who have suffered, those who have been depressed, those who have been oppressed, all of those who have really, really been down so badly. I am an extreme advocate, and knowing how bad it can get. Very determined and very adamant about what I'm doing and what I will do in the future. And because I know. The mind experiencing total chaos, it is simply awful beyond any description. And I know how bad depression can be, and I know just the awful, awful feelings that you have and the darkness and the stuckness. And it is truly, you know, I cannot just say, dismiss that and say, oh, well, no, we have to make the right effort to help out. But it can't be based on naivete, and it can't hit your head against a wall, and sometimes you may need to retreat in order to advance in the future. It's possible. The temperature of the world now, I mean, in taking the temperature, it's not a good temperature. It's got a severe fever. You know, if you're a doctor, you look at take the health, overall health of the world, and you say, this patient is very sick. May need to be quarantined for a while, really. And the doctors may need to wear gauze masks, you know. The doctors may have to stay away for a while, or at least stay at a distance or something, I don't know. So even though subliminally right now, subconsciously, I know the answer, it hasn't quite worked itself to the surface, quite yet, but almost has. There is some, I saw it last night in the dream, there is some resolution of what to do. And whatever it is, I certainly won't give up my advocacy and efforts to clarify and find a way to help those depressed, because I know there is a way, because I've been helped by spiritual mentoring. There's really the only way to do it is through spiritual mentoring. It's the only way. And I was fortunate enough that I was willing to accept the very best mentoring, because I knew without it I was doomed. So I said, give me the best help there possibly is and I'll take it. And that's what happened. So through that spiritual mentoring program, I've been able to distance myself to a great extent from depression and all of the troubles of the mind. But Still, there's the existential problem of the world and how to teach, how to help others, and all that stuff. That's still a big problem. But as far as knowing what causes depression, what causes our troubles, what causes suffering, really, I'm very much on track with that, very much so. And it's not going to get any more obscure. It's going to become clearer and clearer and clearer, of course, of course. And at some point, as Jesus says, he says in A Course in Miracles, he says, I call all of you to take your place among the saviors of the world. Very adamant about that. You have to do it. He said, that's the purpose. I've given this course out for teachers of God, to take your place among the saviors of the world. Well, I haven't done that yet. I say, why? There's some kind of taboo here to speak in those type of terms. But the truth is, you're either a stagehand or you're a savior. There is no other third option. Of course, the ego always says there's a third option to avoid the savior thing, right? The ego says, no, I don't want you to be a savior. And I know you don't want to be a stagehand. So there's a third option. You have to find that. There is no third option. You're either a stagehand, rearranging the staging of the world, or you're a savior from the staging of the world by showing everyone the way, which is to exchange hypothetical scenarios so that you have a happy hypothetical. So you see a blessed world, a world that reflects reality, a world that reminds you of reality. That's the only way. And so those who do that are among the saviors, plural, of the world. In other words, they're working for this savior function, pointing out God's plan of salvation, showcasing it. Those are the saviors of the world, the ones who showcase God's plan of salvation. And that's the whole point of spiritual mentoring, is to eventually do that. That's the whole point of it. So I have to do that. And otherwise, just continue to be a stagehand, rearranging the staging and leading everybody, you know, help leading everyone into darkness, worse and worse and worse and worse darkness, waiting for nothing to show up and to find nothing and become real, which will never happen. All the stagehands are simply waiting for what can never happen. That's all they're doing. So we're either a stagehand waiting for what will never happen, or we're among the saviors of the world. But a savior of the world can't play their role if they haven't accepted their own salvation. So the taboo of accepting our own salvation has to be overcome. And it's a very strong taboo. And looking at it, there's lots of, you know, roadblocks that are put in there, because people think if you're very adamant and certain, and you proclaim yourself to be among the saviors of the world, they say, uh-oh, I hope he doesn't go and turn into some spiritual megalomaniac like Frank Jones or some of the others. There are others too that are just, you know, a lot of those who come out in the world and say that they're, you know, saviors or whatever, they turn out to be fake and megalomaniacs and fall off the rails and just terrible. We've had so much experience with that. We're very reluctant to do that. I know I'm very reluctant to do that, because I say, well, I don't want to turn out like those others. No way. I'll just be quiet. I won't say anything. So you give it these false examples, kind of like stink up the joint, stink everything up. Like one rotten apple spoils the whole bunch kind of thing. So I'm very reluctant to come out that way and say, hey, I know the answer. I'm positive of the answer. I can really help and come on strong, in other words, which is what's needed now. It is needed. We need those who come on strong. But I think right now in the world, they aren't there because there's this fear, like, wait a minute, if I come on strong, maybe I'll turn into some, again, spiritual megalomaniac, which is certainly, nobody wants that. So there's that underlying kind of fear. So that's why I say that some of these situations have really thrown a monkey wrench into the whole situation. And yet if we don't come on strong, their purpose will have seemed to have won out. The purpose is delay. And delay will have succeeded in its purpose, at least for now. So that would be a double tragedy. So I'm trying to shed that reserve. You know, I really have a ton of reserve. Because if you do really come on strong, people, there's going to be a lot of skepticism. People say, uh-oh, you know, here's another one, that kind of thing. And you know, what can you do about that skepticism? I don't know. I've been trying to figure it out. It's just there's a natural kind of wariness now among everybody because we've been burned so many times. There's been quite a few who came on strong, and then later on we found out, oh my God. I mean, it's kind of like been the rule instead of the exception, right? That later on, after they pass away or later on in their lives, we find out that they've been engaged with all sorts of nefarious activities, really, and abuse, and just terrible. And we just, like, after enough of that, you know, he's just on and on and on and on and on. We've been pummeled with that for the last 30 years, maybe 40 years. Good grief. I can't believe it. A lot of teachers, I thought, wow, they're so well known. Everyone says they're so wonderful. And then later on you find out, my gosh, they were they couldn't walk the walk. They couldn't walk the walk at all. And of course, some of them get pulled down. It's almost always a relationship with women, with men teachers. It's always a woman sometime, somewhere, that they get involved with that, and things start to deteriorate. And it just seems like we don't have it sorted out properly in today's day and age. The idea of having a relationship with the teacher and all this stuff, it just seems to be, it's incredible how our culture is not properly set up to enable teachers to teach. I think some of them may have started out with good intentions or something, and just simply the pressures were so severe, they just couldn't handle the situation. But there's a lot of different situations. I mean, the women gurus have trouble too. Different kinds of trouble. Oftentimes greed, and they want to go on shopping sprees and live in the finest hotels and money thing, you know. As one spiritual teacher that was highly thought of, who set herself on fire and burned herself to death just because who knows why. Just like, whoa. And so the track record of those who claim to be teachers has been atrocious. So of course you look at it and you say, whoa, you know, is there some dynamic I'm not seeing? Is there something here that, you know, I don't want to go into that. That is for sure. I don't want to crash and burn like Icarus, you know, flying too close to the sun. No way. But on the other hand, Jesus saying, come on, you've been spiritual mentored for so long. It's time for, you know, take your place. And I'm just saying, wow, well, you know, it's kind of 50-50. I'm trying to weigh it and get it. Say, come on, it's worth the so-called risk, because I can certainly drop my reserve. I don't have to have so much reserve. But if someone who seems so certain is immediately suspect. But on the other hand, we need certainty. See, we're in a situation where this rain is going to come down, and we need certainty. We need a roof over our heads. Really. I had a roof over my head. I was watching the rain, and I had windows all around. I was watching. I said, good grief. I'm glad I'm not out in that rain. It's just going to crush your umbrella. I mean, it's going to beat you into the ground. And I thought, I wonder if my house is going to stand. Well, it stood, because it's built on a solid foundation. A very solid foundation. But, again, I don't trust it entirely based on all the problems that just so many teachers have had. And of course, the problems get magnified in the media because the ego loves to talk about that stuff and magnify and say, hey, look at this, trying to scare us all. But it's done a pretty good job of scaring us, because I just don't see that kind of adamancy. The teachers are way too reserved these days, in my opinion. They're not just, you know, hollering from the rooftops. They're saying, you know, they're not on fire. They're not on fire. They're saying, hey, we, they're not just... wow. And it's going to be too late very soon. It's going to be too late very soon. If you get out in that rain, you're going to have to have somewhere to shelter from the rain. You're going to need shelter from this rain. R-E-I-G-N. Okay. R-E-I-G-N. The Raj, that is the coming. The American Raj is about to take place. And we're the sepoys. You know, we're the ones who are going to have our land, confiscated in order to plant opium poppies and indigo and tea and cash crops, etc. Use analogy, which actually happened under the East India Company, not as much under the Raj, but the severe famines, some of them did happen under the British Raj, and because they tried to rearrange everything, you see, we have an example of an intense reign, the British Raj, in India, and I will highlight that over maybe at the Big Boost. The Big Boost is here now channel. I'm working on stuff to just like give you a bigger context, a wider picture, make you feel a little more educated with a greater contextual understanding of everything that might be helpful to you. So you're not so easily intimidated. So you feel like, hey, it's time to get out of the rain. Take shelter out of the rain. When the rain is coming down like that, you need to get under a roof. Very important. So the idea was the British administration thought that they had the capacity to modernize the whole situation and felt that their ways were right and based on spiritual principles that were inviolate, and they didn't properly see the context of the whole situation and were too driven by mercenary business interests and profit motive, and Royal Britannia, the United Kingdom, and basically, you talk about the number of people who starved to death, the number of people who died from all sorts of illnesses that because of compromised immune systems, compromised health, et cetera, et cetera. It was just a gulag. It was horrible. Not that that hasn't happened in the past, but it became exacerbated, certainly. And there was just, you try to fit a round peg into a square hole, thinking that you're full of righteousness and you know what's best, and it causes catastrophes. And so you get that type of Raj, that type of rain coming, and it's big trouble, especially for the round pegs, it was good for their profits. I know the East India Company, had made a lot of profit selling opium to China, getting everyone addicted over there. But it wasn't good for the farmers that didn't have any rice when the monsoon didn't come. They didn't store any rice. You see, what happened was they wanted to make profits in all the grain, so they sold all the grain around the world to their various colonies, made a ton of money. They didn't store any grain. See? Then when the monsoon failed, southeastern oscillation failed. No rice, no grain, no food, no life, etc., etc. So mankind has done some incredibly foolish things and continues to, and will continue to, if you understand the roots of existence, what's going on, the purpose. You have to know that existence continues. It's vast folly. It can't get out of its own way. It's impossible. It cannot. Always the worm Ouroboros devouring itself continuously. And we are headed into another Raj, another rain. Be a short-lived one, but it will be incredibly destructive, incredibly intense. Now, my mood during that rainstorm, I was just noticing, observing, and saying, wow, this is really intense. But I wasn't panicking. I wasn't freaked out exactly, no. And you need those who are not freaked out. You need those in this who are can have calm, who understand, who anticipated, who expected, who have prepared a roof, who have prepared a foundation that will stand up, a foundation not built on sand or straw, but on a rock of certitude. That's very important now. So certainly I have to, if I want to be of any assistance, any of you want to be of assistance, you have to have that the great certitude really needs to come during this time. And the only way you get that is exchange hypotheticals. You can't get it simply by conceptually, the speed of conceptualization. Because that'll burn you out, and it doesn't work. You'll say, wait a minute, I'm conceptualizing, it's not good enough. When the intensity of the rain is there, now people are looking to you for immediate reassurance. Yeah, no time to wait anymore. So that's the problem that I'm in, and everyone who wants to help, they're in the same boat. We're all in the same boat. We need to give immediate reassurance. Right this instant. Yeah, no conceptualization necessary. People have to look and see immediately. There's the roof. There's the reassurance. You can't be saying, well, I'm building a roof. It's going to get there. I'm almost there. No, it's no good. It's no good. And we could go on and conceptualize this whole thing and explain it, but as Ananda Mahima said, all this conceptualization is fine, but it's knowledge about nothing, really. You have all this knowledge about nothing, all this clarity about nothing, but at some point you need knowledge about knowledge. Knowledge has to know itself. Knowledge has to experience itself as knowledge, which is knowledge is simply full of knowledge. And without that, there is not immediate reassurance. There is not. So at this point, we're still coming up short, which is not a good thing. But at least awareness of that is helpful. Awareness of your shortcomings is helpful. That's what humility is all about. Every day you should get up and say, why am I coming up short? See, humility is based on experiencing the goal, having a glimpse of it. And then you realize, hey, I'm coming up short of that. How do I not come up short? And each day you have to get up and say, well, keep working. Say, I'm coming up short. Why? And it's a tough one. And it's the totality, it's the sum total of all of the defenses we use. That's why we're coming up short. It's not any one in particular, it's the sum total, always. It's the sum total. And then when we see that, then we can realize, wow, the remedy has to be a sum total also. It has to be total. The remedy has to be total. It has to deal with the totality of the situation, like that. We cannot do it piecemeal. Piecemeal is only good enough to recognize the totality of the situation. But then you see the totality of the situation, and you say, wow, I have to have a total cure. It cannot be partial. It's not possible. The problem is total. That's a total problem we have. Now, we say it's the ego. The ego is the problem. But if you really want to know the truth, then we should say that, speak the plain truth here is that there is no ego. There is no ego. And that's the most frightening thing of all for us, really, is that what we want is we want delay. And because we're afraid of God, we're uncertain about continuity and all this stuff. So we want delay. We want to say, well, wait a minute, we're not quite ready to drop this idea. So how do we do that? We want to bargain. We want to bargain. So we invent, we imagine there's something to bargain with, that we need to bargain with. But we make like the bargainer be the bad guy. That we're the ones who say, I want enlightenment, yeah. But there's something there that doesn't want it, and I need to bargain with this and bargain with and convince it or something. So we just imagine there's an ego, there's a bargainer, someone to bargain with. Essentially, the ego is something to bargain with. That's it. But there isn't any such thing. It's entirely our own wishful thinking, our own imagination. There is no ego at all, which is for most a very frightening thing. I realize that today. There is no ego. And I just said, oh yeah, I see that. It's obvious. It's just we've just invented something to bargain with. It's not there. So really, when you see how bad the situation is, you realize that there's nothing to bargain with. It's either black or white. It's either this or that. There is no one to bargain with. Which is very sobering. Very sobering. I mean, because it necessitates an actual choice. No one to bargain with. There's no ego to bargain with. So all the time you're talking about ego, what you're really saying is, in the back of your mind, you're saying, well, there's someone to bargain with. There's something there I can bargain with, and I need to bargain with, and I need to fight with that, and I need to overcome it. And it's not there. There is no such thing as an ego. There is not. And that's advanced teaching. And I can say it didn't bother me at all seeing that. It wasn't bother. I said, oh, good. That's great. Finally, I see there is no ego. But of course, that flies in the face. Most of the time you're on the spiritual path, you want to believe that there's an ego and it's obstructing you and it's holding you back, and you're bargaining with it and trying to convince it. All it's very comforting to have this notion that there's an ego there. But now I see there's never been an ego there. There isn't anything there. There's nothing at all there. There's nothing holding us back except our desire to be prime creator. But that's nothing at all. It can never be realized. So there's really nothing at all holding us back in the ultimate sense. Everything is just that we're imagining because we want to delay. We want to believe that there's something holding us back. So we invent it. We imagine it. It's not there. It's not there. There is no ego. Never has been. There are no ego dynamics. Not really. It's all invented. We've invented this ego. We've invented dynamics. We put it all on supposedly this ego. It's not coming from any ego at all. It's entirely coming from our desire to be prime creator, our choosing the idea of wanting to become prime creator, and that necessitating a change in reality, which would annihilate reality. So therefore, we're entertaining this hypothetical scenario of a contingency plan in case reality is destroyed. It all comes from that. It comes from the root and from nowhere else. Nowhere else. It doesn't come from some ego out there trying to lead us astray, some adversary. There is no adversary. There is none. There isn't any adversary whatsoever. It is simply spirit chose that idea, and simply spirit needs to choose another idea. Choose again. Exchange hypotheticals. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which gives rise to the hypothetical of what if reality could never be destroyed. And then exchange, just make that exchange. That's the only remedy there is. The remedy isn't to kill the ego. How can you kill the ego? There is no ego. See? That's the worry. When people say, well, there's an ego, they keep thinking, well, if I just kill the ego, that will be succeeding. Because they say, no, I don't want to exchange hypotheticals. I'm too frightened of God. But I know there's a way I can kill the ego. Well, in order to kill the ego, there'd have to be an ego, right? And so you'd have to make nothing something. It's impossible. There isn't any ego, so you can't kill the ego. You can only exchange hypotheticals. But killing the ego comes out of fear of God. Ultimately, our problem might be said is the fear of God, because we're afraid that that reality can be annihilated, and we're afraid that God's angry at us for finding some way to annihilate God. We want an angry at us. All the dynamics of the idea brings about fear of God, which is, we in order to work on this contingency plan, we imagine, hey, we need some motivation. Well, how about saying that God insisted upon this contingency plan? And really is telling us secretly, whispering, hey, you know what? One of these days, I'm going to quit my job and reality's going to be destroyed and you're going to need this contingency plan. So I'm just, for your own good, I'm telling you, you got to work on the contingency plan. And that's, oh my gosh, you know, we've invented all that. We've put all these words in God's mouth, and then we're afraid of, you know, this imaginary God that we put words into the mouth of. None of that is true. None of it is true. There's no reason to fear God whatsoever. But we invent plausible excuses to be afraid. We invent the ego. We invent a God that tells us that this God made all this staging, and that we're supposed to be here working on the staging, and there's some great purpose to it all. All utter nonsense that we've just invented. We've just made it up, wishful thinking, as motivational tools, because we're having a hard time with this contingency plan. We're tired of waiting. We're starting to think like, hey, maybe we can't succeed at this, and that scares us. The real fear we have, I guess, would be then the fact that we feel we're going to fail at this endeavor, at this contingency plan, and they say, oh my gosh, we're going to be vulnerable to annihilation then. So I guess that's, and we get this mixed up with fear of God, fear of annihilation, thinking, oh, if we're annihilated, then God must want to annihilate us or something. No, it's the idea we chose, which would necessitate a change in reality, which would then annihilate all of reality. It's our idea. We chose the idea, not God. God didn't tell us to choose that idea. And so since we're failing at this contingency plan, we're feeling this failure, we're saying, uh-oh, we're going to be annihilated. And so we think, well, no, wait a minute, I better annihilate the ego and the power of annihilation. I say, I can get the ego. The ego's the bad one. There is no ego. There is no annihilation. There is no need for any contingency plan. All that can be seen. All that can be seen. All of this can be seen. If you get the right spiritual mentoring, you can see it all. Plain as day, plainer than day. You have a way to see it through using the capacity you have for clarification, however you want to describe it, it's capacity for clarification that you have within you. But you don't know it's there until you try, until you start to exercise it. It's like someone who doesn't know they can sing until they try to sing. I never tried to sing. I thought I couldn't sing at all. And then one day I got this sort of invitation, say, sort of internal thing, say, why don't you try to sing? I said, are you crazy? I can't sing. And I was totally afraid I couldn't sing at all. And then I just started singing and I found out I could sing. Not that that's necessarily a good thing at all. Because again, my downfall was, again, trying to help the world, and then I seen that people were so messed up, they couldn't understand, wouldn't exercise their clarity, and then the easy reason was that, hey, maybe we can, they're so used to the ego's way of doing things, maybe we can make both truth and lies true, or make some way to live with the disparity, which brings in entertainment into the picture. So the entertainment, the purpose is really to find a way to be comfortable with your inability to integrate the two. We're supposed to integrate them as much as possible. That's the ego's plan. And then the final part that you can't integrate all the way, we're supposed to fill that gap with entertainment and the pleasures of the flesh, all the corporal pleasures that we can come up with, whatever they may be, the whole palette of pleasure. We're supposed to fill it with that. So the ego says you want to be a savior of the world, and its plan is work on filling that gap, work on integrating and also filling the gap with the entertainment. So it's probably the ego that told me to sing and saying, hey, you should sing. And so I worked on singing for a long time. And then I said, you know what? No matter how much I practice, I'm still just so-so, really. You know, so-so. That's all. I'll never be really outstanding. No. Good, yeah, but good is not good enough. Good is not good enough. And so I said, forget it. You know, and the entertainment, the whole thing with entertainment, we don't realize what its purpose is. But I finally took a long time to wise up to that. It's really the ego's plan. It's the ego's plan. Fill that final dissatisfaction with entertainment, which is why ego's promoting everybody to have these huge screens in their homes and sound systems, etc., because its plan is all about entertainment. It's all about trying to fill that gap of futility. The last step, which can never take place. You know, the ego leads you down this path and then finally tells, well, you know, guess what? Well, you can't quite succeed, but that's okay. Because we'll fill that dissatisfaction with entertainment. So, I've been there too. I've been through the whole thing. Waiting for nothing to show up. Working on entertaining the troops as they wait, entertain them as they wait, and trying to, you know, see how can I teach people how to be better entertainers? Because I was cast in that role too. I had to be like some super aware of how to produce better entertainment, and what constitutes, you know, is there a way to school people to be better entertainers? I was very much got tremendous amount of instruction in that. Which turned out to be a dead end. I gradually worked through it and realized this isn't it. This isn't it. It's not the answer. But it seems like an easier fit to the problem, right? Because people are just like comatose here, really. And how do you help someone comatose? They're just saying, "Hey, we're so futile, man. We're just, you know." What can you do with our futility, this feeling? Look, come on, can't you entertain us? You just give us something. And you say, oh, what do you want? Oh, just give me some better entertainment. I just want to feel better. He said, well, yeah, I could do that. I could sing me a song, you know. Good grief. It's temporary. It doesn't solve the problem at all. And it just drives the entertainers to death, really. I was in an assisted living place once when I was really into this entertainment thing. And I had my guitar, and there was this lady that was just in a wheelchair. She was so messed up. She couldn't stand up. It was so hard to deal with, and she was hopeless. And I got the idea of like, hey, why don't I start singing to her? So I started singing to her. And she ended up getting out of the wheelchair and trying to dance. And everybody was just completely blown away. I had several situations in assisted living where my singing and playing had people suddenly affecting some kind of miraculous quote-unquote cure, but it wasn't any cure, because after I stopped, she went right back to the wheelchair. You know, she was still devastated, and what am I supposed to come? People are saying, well, you're supposed to come to the assisted living place every day and spend your time singing there for the people, and that's going to help them or something. Well, it might give them just a little twinge of satisfaction, like, oh, I got out of the wheelchair or something. They're still going to die. They're still on tons of medication. And I'd spend all my time and energy for a symbolic gesture like that. It's crazy, absolutely crazy. Terrible use of time. And yet I got led down that road. Can you believe it? Spent an incredible amount of time and effort on all that. It's the road of futility. And that's why entertainers end up on drugs. They end up being like wiped out, like poor Michael Jackson. You know, he was a heck of an entertainer. But the ego, there's no ego, but the dynamics of this dream drove him to think he wanted to help people so badly that he just killed himself, worked himself to death, trying to find a way to do it. Not that he was some saint or anything, he wasn't. But he was an entertainer. And there are many entertainers like that. I mean, the stories are endless of entertainers that get driven to just because they just feel like this is the only way to help the world. And somebody's got to find a way to be the perfect entertainer. And I'm going to have to try my best to do it because I have all these gifts, etc. And they just burn themselves out and get on drugs and he can't sleep. And it's just absolutely horrific. And he gets severe depression, all of that stuff. Because that's not the way. Entertainment is not the way. And yet this whole world now is being hardwired into entertainment as the way. Instead of satsang. Instead of inquiry. Instead of clarification. Clarification is not entertainment. It's clarification. And when you have the expectations of a planet that are so hardwired into entertainment being the answer, you're up against a brick wall. Concrete slab. You're going to need jackhammers, hammer drills. You're going to need hammer drill. Get the hammer drills out and, start breaking the slab up. You got to be slab breakers the way things are going now. So, those are brutal lessons that I learned. Really, they were brutal. But once learned, and that way, they're likely to stay learned. The ego has this maniacal faith in its plan because what else can it do? It just tells you that you're supposed to do your role and you've got to do your role in its plan, otherwise it won't work. But your role doesn't work, and you beat yourself up. You drive yourself relentlessly thinking that, hey, there's a way to save the world and this is the way, and if I do my utmost to make us succeed, I have to do that, otherwise I'll feel guilt. But it's the wrong way. The ego is the wrong way. And again, I use the ego as if there were one. There isn't any such ego. It's our wishes to delay. So really, the way we try to help ourselves is simply our own wish to delay, our own wish to succeed at this contingency plan. Which means delaying until we figure a way to succeed, because we don't want to keep working on it. We don't. Nobody wants to keep working on this plan. We all hate it. That's a fact. Everybody hates it. If they're honest, they say they absolutely hate this plan. It's terrible. Miserable. The Bataan Death March is all that it is. But we're afraid to let go of it because we think, well, if we don't succeed, we might get annihilated. That's the catch-22. So we keep trying to figure out ways to motivate ourselves, and we have to keep deceiving ourselves and tricking ourselves and claiming that the ego is doing it instead of we're the ones doing it. There's no ego. We're the ones deceiving ourselves. Saying, yeah, that we can have both truth and lies. We can accommodate both of them. We don't have to choose either one. Let's just have both. And then the final lack of integration, let's just fill that up with entertainment. Let's all be happy. Let's just party. Let's just have all the wine and the food and the drink and the sex and the drugs and the rock and roll and the big screen and the entertainment, and let's all just be thrilled by it and forget about the futility. Just forget about this feeling, this nagging feeling like something's not right. I'm not happy. Just forget about it. Make happy. Let's everybody make happy. Instead of choosing the happy hypothetical, let's all make happy. And so that's the push. That's the push that's coming. That's the push that's been going on. That's the worldwide push that's coming. That's the rain that is coming. The Oba rain, you can call it. The Oba rain is coming. The Oba rain. Oba means king, actually. Look it up. Oba means king. And Ma, putting Ma as king. What is Ma really? Entertainment. Entertainment. The flesh. The nurturing of the, what can the flesh give you? What can Ma give you? The mother, what can mother give you? Mother can give you all the food and the drink and the song and the lullabies and ultimately the entertainment, etc. It's the flesh. That's not clarity. The mother is not clarity. So Oba means king and Ma is mother. So putting the mother as king is the reign that we're going into. Of course, Oba Ma, Obama. It's the way to really pronounce it. Oba Ma is the right way to truly pronounce it. That's the reign that we're going into. Putting the mother as king on the throne, as it were. Queen, Queen Bee on the throne. And the Queen Bee is entertainment. And you see now, if you see the shows, it's all about, it's the women that are in charge of introducing all these shows and these acts. And here it is. Look at that. They're the ringmasters now. The ringmasters. Because they bring more to the table, because they bring that memory of childhood to us and being an infant and needing the nurturance of the mother. So the females say, here is the nurturance. Here's your nurturance. And then they're presenting all this as entertainment. So we have very difficult time to sidestep that. We really do. Everyone is extraordinarily difficult time. And there's some that are resisting it conceptually, but they're in big trouble. At some point that they'll be big trouble. You need to sidestep it through clarity and ultimately knowledge. Not conceptuality, you have to go beyond that. Certitude, you have to have spiritual mentoring in order to avoid these times. You have to, not just conceptually, but spiritual mentoring that has momentum to take you beyond the conceptual. I see there are those who are resisting it at the conceptual level. And I say, you're just going to end up hitting your head against the wall. You know, you're going to be in big trouble. The intellect isn't enough. Conceptual level is not enough. It's not enough. It's positive. So hopefully you have spiritual momentum. Hopefully you've had spiritual mentoring. And you have the momentum you need. I hope I have the momentum I need. That's yet to be determined, because again, the using the nurturing aspect of the mother as the hook into this entertainment situation is nasty business. That's hardball. That's hitting below the belt. And so the spiritual mentoring has to be really something extraordinary to succeed at this point. Now, I believe A Course in Miracles is certainly extraordinary. And Sri Anandamayi Ma, certainly extraordinary. Ramana Maharshi, certainly extraordinary. So certainly there's been extraordinary spiritual mentoring available. And there are others, too, that are certainly extraordinary. But have we taken it to heart? Do we have the momentum? Is a question that's going to be answered pretty soon. Pretty soon. Because who can go against the mother? That's the big question, isn't it? Very interesting thing about Sri Anandamayi Ma. Everybody called her the mother. They call her Ma. Anandamayi Ma, 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 Ma. And she always said, no, 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 no. Don't see me. I'm not the mother. Don't see me as the mother. But she's very kind about it. And when people tried to cast her in the role of mother, she'd play like she was like a little child. She'd go into that little child routine, which she had incredibly great at it. I don't know what that was like, because it's not been captured on video or pictures, really. But they say that she was just unbelievable. She could be the most endearing little girl act imaginable, because she didn't want to be seen as the mother, because she knew that's a problem. But what do you do? What do you do when you go into an insane asylum? You got to play an act. You got an act. You got to humor them, right? You got to humor. You can't just be adamant. When Jesus came 2,000 years ago, he told those who came to see him, he said, hey, you know, you don't understand. You can't handle the direct truth right now. So I have to speak in parables and allegories, all this stuff. He said, later on, the Holy Spirit will clarify everything and you'll be able to handle the truth directly, but you can't handle it. So not in my mind. Nah, she wasn't advocating mother worship. She wasn't advocating all the stuff that the puja, the Durga puja, and the Kali puja, and the whole all the religious festivals, etc. She's not an advocate of that, but she's not against it. I mean, it's just like she's not. She's not against dreaming. Truth is not against dreaming. It just says change the dream. Take a happy dream instead of this nightmare. So that discipline in those festivals is a good thing. So there are good attributes. It brings people together. But she wasn't against it, but she wasn't advocating it either. But she said, okay, this is when in Rome, do as Rome do. These are the festivals. I'll participate in them. I'll play along. And at the same time, I will start to slip in the clarification that's needed, the needed clarification, which is what she did. She was not an advocate of that stuff. And did not agree that she was the mother, anyone's mother at all. Did not agree with that, but she would use that term to humor people. But she said, hey, see me as your sister or your daughter or as just a little child, crazy little child. Don't see me as the mother. Very wise, super wise, because we're all equal. No one's left reality. We're all equal. No one's left reality. And this world is not our mother. It'll never be our mother. It's a vicious monster. It's out to destroy us. It's out to devour us. It believes in annihilation. It hates us. It fears us. It's a horrible nightmare. There's no mother. And the nurturance we need is clarity. Its clarity is the nurturance we need. Not worshiping some mother. She don't want to be worshipped as a mother. Worshiping of the mother is saying, give us some things of the flesh we want. Please give us a way to be happy within this context. You cannot be happy within this context. It's impossible. You cannot reconcile truth and lies. It's impossible. You cannot reconcile the fact that reality cannot be changed in any way, and the desire that reality can be changed. Either reality can be changed or it can't. You can't reconcile those two. It's impossible. No mother can reconcile those two. And the problem is we're trying to reconcile the two and we're miserable, so we're looking for some mother to soothe us. You know, it's like, what do we do when we're suffering? What do we do? We run to our mother, and mother calms us down, say, everything's okay, don't worry. But as long as we avoid clarification, we will remain in this horrible nightmare, and we'll need continuous reassurance and calming from, you know, from some source. And it's like me going into a assisted living place and singing a song. Sure, it reassures them for a little bit, and then the nightmares come back. And it goes on and endlessly that way. That's no way. It's a complete waste of everyone's time. It's a lose-lose scenario. So worshiping the mother is a lose-lose scenario. It's a waste of everyone's time. Everyone's time. Because you want to be calm. You want to be soothed and saying, hey, don't worry. It's okay. Just hang in there and everything's fine. No, it's not fine. Because you're trying to accomplish the impossible, and that feeling of futility will always be there. And that's suffering. And ultimately, if you try to reconcile opposite mutual exclusives, you're going to end up with severe depression, and you may end up like I ended up, with a state of total mental chaos, and that's terrible beyond description. So it's not fine. It's not fine. You don't need to worship a mother. You don't need mother worship. You need spiritual mentoring. And I mean you collectively, everyone. I'm not excluding anyone from this. I'm not singling anyone out. I'm not excluding anyone. It's a completely generalized statement. Everybody needs spiritual mentoring. Don't need mother worshiping. We need spiritual mentoring. Very adamant about that. I never saw none of my mind as a mother figure. No. I saw her as a friend, as a spiritual mentor, as a brother in Christ, as fellow spirit, and as one that was an expert. As an expert. Total expert. Perfect showcasing of the happy hypothetical. So I found her as profoundly useful. Ultimately, what gurus are, they're useful. You must see him as profoundly useful. But that's it. I don't bow. It's not, sure, out of reverence for their usefulness, but I don't bow in worship. It's not appropriate to worship a brother in spirit, the sonship of Christ. It's not appropriate to be worshiping any of that. No way. I don't even worship Jesus. He's part of the sonship, and he doesn't want to be. He says it's not appropriate. Worship is appropriate to God, the prime creator. But not to the any aspect of the sonship. It is inappropriate. But gratitude and the whole dynamic that comes with recognizing usefulness and expertise, that is absolutely appropriate. Which is, I would say, a kind of intelligent deference. You defer. There's a deference there. You defer. You say, okay, you know how to use time right, correctly. Therefore, I'm going to go along with the way that you're suggesting I use my time. That's what I did. I said, okay, I'll defer. At least the best I could. Which is why I feel justified in making these videos, is because I do have some expertise, and then that intelligent deference to listen is justified. At least the way I see it, it's right use of time. It's a good way to use time, actually. It's not the ultimate best way. I'm sure that ultimately there are better ways. But it is the best I can do at the moment, and I feel at some point there'll be better ways. So the appropriate attitude is intelligent deference, okay? And a sense of gratitude that goes along with that. That's a part of intelligent deference. You say, hey, I need help. I really need help. I need spiritual mentoring. And I recognize expertise when I see it. And the intelligent thing to do is be deferential and be intelligent deferential and to pay attention and to use time in the way that's being suggested, etc. That is the way to approach the whole thing. That's the way society needs to be set up. That's the way a culture needs to be set up. We don't need to spend our time worshiping. Intelligent deference is the way it should be set up. I mean, we're in no position to be worshiping God. We have no idea what God is in the first place right now. We're so confused and upside down and backwards. It's a waste of time. We need to get clarity first and then recognize the remedy is to exchange hypotheticals, and then that hypothetical will reconcile us to reality, and then once in reality, the way to worship in reality is to exercise your freedom, to function as God created you. That's worship of God. That's the worship God wants. So we are here in this world trying to worship God. We don't know what we're doing. No idea what we're doing. That's not the way. The way is intelligent deference, spiritual mentoring, clarification. That is the way. And those waters have been kind of muddied a little bit, but we can unmuddy them. We have to unmuddy them. And there has to be some intelligent deference coming to the picture at some point. Now, during this reign, is coming up, the reign of the mother. Mother is king. Mother is Oba. Ma-Oba. The reign of Ma-Oba. You might put it that way. It's Ma-Oba. The reign of Ma-Oba. It's coming up. And, hey, she's going to say, hey, let's party, everybody, entertainment. It's entertainment time. It's restructuring time. We're going to have a big restructuring party. We're all restructure the staging. Restage everything. Let's restage it all. Let's restage it all. Come on. It's going to be fun. Let's do it. Let's go for it. And when you get tired and burned out, we got all these hot entertainment for you. Really hot stuff. Hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter. Whatever hot stuff is supposed to mean for anyone. They're going to have hot stuff for everybody. Interestingly enough, I went through a spell last summer of getting into hot sauce. Ghost peppers and habaneros. And I went through the whole thing. The hottest of the hottest of the hottest of the hottest. I went through it all. And I really compromised my health, actually. Ended up being quite problematical. And so I decided, hey, I've been there, done that, that's it. And I quit, got rid of everything, gave away all my hot stuff, all the hot sauces, gave it to people here who wanted it, gave the plants away, everything. And my health has returned to normal now. And I feel good, I feel really good. But that hot sauce, as it were, was a metaphor for what's coming in the world. And, you know, the Romans were really into hot stuff back in the day when they were slaughtering all the Christians who weren't into that, they wanted clarity. They were a little confused, of course. Well, you don't take people who have mislearned the lessons of this hypothetical, who have learned the lessons of this hypothetical to an incredible extent, you just don't come in and snap your fingers and they all and learn it all just like that. So Jesus wasn't naive. So the early Christians were certainly doing their best, but they themselves might have been a little naive, you know. And the Romans were really into entertainment. They were trying to fill that gap, and they were bad news. And they were really into the hot stuff back then. Was really hot. The entertainment was really hot, as in, you know, the gladiators and the Colosseum and all sorts of other stuff too. They were extraordinarily decadent. And for them, they thought it was the ultimate sophistication. It was the ultimate, and for them, they thought it was salvation, because they were distracting themselves. They were delaying themselves. They were trying to fill that gap of in between the third option the ego claims is there and it's not there. What's there is futility. That's not an option. How is futility an option? It's not. And the ego says, well, don't worry, it's really an option, but if you just be entertained, it'll be fine, don't worry. It's not, futility is not an option. And entertainment won't change that. So the Romans tried to use every kind of entertainment possible, and they spent their time dreaming up all sorts of stuff. I mean, they would bring in all the wild animals from the four corners of the globe and pit them against each other. And you see on YouTube a lot of these CGI stuff of various beasts being pitted against death matches. Oh, we're going back to Roman times. Let's be honest, okay? We are. You see all these horror. The Whore of Babylon is in full vogue right now. She's in charge. She's in charge. Oh, goddess of destruction, Whore of Babylon. Same thing. She's in charge now. The Ma Oba. Ma is the Oba now. Is the king. She's in charge. And this is a fact. It's not just some allegory. This is a fact. That is true. And there may even be a persona here in this world who personifies that Ma Oba, actually. And she is in charge of culture and society of this planet right now. And she's in charge of the entertainment. And she tried to enlist my help, most definitely, to try and sugarcoat it, knowing that I could do a fabulous job at that. And so I know all about this. And what happens is, like when you get into hot sauce, first I start out very mild, and then gradually I got used to it and increased the heat, and then gradually, and then I went to a habanero sauce, and then I just put a little bit, and gradually I was able to get more and more, until I was at the point where I could eat a whole tablespoon of it, straight, and then another one, and then I went to the ghost peppers, and those really rocked my world. Those hit you at a whole different level. that hits your nervous system. But ghost peppers, look out. And it brings about unexpected consequences too. As in when it comes out the other end, that brings great troubles as well, you see. So you can kill the heat here, but you can't kill the heat down there, as it were. And it causes problems in your metabolism and your insides, your digestive system, a lot of stuff. It's bad news. But what happens is you build up a tolerance for the heat. And so you're able to take more and more and more, and you want more and more and more. It's very addictive. Hot sauce is very addictive. Because it knocks out your it's so intense. It knocks out this ennui that we have. This ennui of futility that we have, which is inevitable when we're trying to reconcile entertain mutual exclusives, reconcile mutual exclusives or entertain them. We have this ennui, we have this third option the ego keeps claiming, which is no ego, we keep imagining that the imaginary ego is claiming, so we don't realize it's coming from us. We imagine that there's this third option, which is futility, really. And this futility, it has this terrible feeling, either depression or boredom or ennui, whatever. And we try to knock that feeling out. People try to use alcohol to knock it out. They try to use sex. They try to use drugs. They try to use music. They try to use entertainment of all different kinds. Frivolity, any games, whatever they can do with their mind and try to get rid of that feeling of futility. And so the hot sauce, it gives you a momentary reprieve from that feeling. It really does. And the ghost pepper, good Lord. I said, oh my gosh, this could be very addictive. Very addictive. I realized, wow, I could end up eating ghost pepper all the time. It's going to trash my insides. I want to be trashed. This is scary business, really. Because it gives you temporary euphoria. It's so painful. It's so stressful. It engages you so much, you forget about this boredom. You're thinking like, can I breathe? Can I speak? It's like a mini death. It really is like you're almost dying. Tell you the truth. It's exactly what it is. I mean, there was actually a video of it. I taped it. I haven't shown it yet, but I actually felt like I might die. I wasn't sure if I was going to survive or not. And so your mind becomes profoundly engaged with this death struggle. And I could hardly breathe. I couldn't speak. And I didn't know how long I was going to go on. I thought it might never end. It was, you know, really intense. And that's what the ghost pepper does. That's what drugs do. That's what sex does. That's all that stuff. You know, you see people like, what are they called? Like having sex with and choking themselves and all these really dangerous practices. They're trying to give themselves this such an intense body experience that they're almost dying, that their mind is super engaged and it forgets about futility for a little while. And then of course the futility creeps right back in and you have to do it again, and it has to be more intense because in your mind you realize, hey, the last time didn't really solve the problem. So drugs are incredibly addictive. Those people who claim that drugs are not addictive are very naive, extraordinarily naive and dangerous, because their naivete is very dangerous. And you need to listen to experts. If you're smart, you listen to experts. Don't fool around with dilettantes, okay? Drugs do accelerate. They do increase. You do go down a path which is not good, and those people say, "Well, sure, there are some people who don't go down that path." Well, really, they probably find other ways to do it. It's an overall syndrome, but so many do go down because when this feeling of futility gets strong enough, when you try to integrate mutual exclusives strong enough, the futility gets very strong, and then you'll get desperate. And you'll try something. You're going to try something for sure. There's no doubt about it. And then whatever it is, if it's you use drugs, you're going to go into harder and harder, greater and greater doses. If you try sex, you're going to get into more and more deviance and go become more and more deviant. And that gets very bad. If you try whatever you try, where it's Epicureanism, food, you can become more and more of a glutton. Where there's money, you're going to become more and more and more greedy. You want more and more and more and more. You'll end up like Madoff, that kind of thing, you know, where you can't control it anymore. It takes over. Happens to everybody. It will happen to you, to anyone, if you don't get the right spiritual mentoring. And usually people wait until they hit the bottom, until they get spiritual mentoring. They finally agree. Says, wow, this futility thing isn't working out for me. Because the if you try to experience futility directly, which is what I did, you experience total chaos. And that's completely untenable. So of course people don't want to experience that total chaos. So they're desperate for some in the ego, in the quote unquote imaginary ego, says, oh sure, here's some stuff. This'll help you. And that's the Romans, they did it all. They'd be having a totally deviant orgy. They would be feasting on the finest kind of gluttony imaginable, and always. They'd be taking whatever drugs were available. They'd have the most incredibly decadent entertainment possible, and then they'd have these blood sports going on at the same time, all at the same time. And music, of course, a beautiful someone with a lyre and a flute, whatever they had, providing this beautiful sugarcoating for it all. Like, oh, we're all in heaven, you know, we must be in heaven, listen to that harp. That's exactly what they did. That's exactly where we're headed. And we're way, way, way into it. We're in the quicksand over our heads already. Hell-bent on getting rid of that futility. And into that situation steps those who know the truth about the situation. And I am one of those, but could be more effective for sure. And I need to be more effective. Because you really almost have to grab people, you know, by the scruff of the neck at this time. You know, it's that bad. It's that bad. You really got to, you know, grab them and say, hey, you know, use your intelligent deference. And of course people are like worried, oh, I better not defer, this might be a spiritual megalomaniac, I better not defer. That's the ego set that roadblock up ahead of time. You see, the ego set that up. And again, it's the imaginary ego, we set it up. We set it up, meaning the desire to be prime creator set that up, a roadblock ahead of time, which is to make us frightened of intelligent deference. Because again, that Frank Jones came on the scene and he was so super intelligent that we gave him intelligent deference, or at least we considered giving it to him, considered it, and then others of that ilk, and then that got abused. Intelligence deference got abused. It was like a trick. It was kind of saying like, here I am. I am the god of futility. I am the god of the gap, who will take away all your problems, all the problems of futility. I am now here. I have bestowed my blessings upon this world, and here I am, and all you have to do is worship me. And so, in other words, give total intelligent deference, which ultimately total deference. And again, I say, it's totally inappropriate to worship any of the sonship. Sonship should not be worshiping itself. It should be worshiping God. And Frank Jones was not God. He was an aspect of the sonship. So asking us to worship him was totally inappropriate. And so it was an abuse of intelligent deference there. And gradually, the more intelligent among us, who of course are looking for intelligent deference, I mean, I was desperate for it, being knowing that what futility leads to, the total chaos, that you're you know, that gets played upon, and you want to find somebody. And at first you say, well, maybe he's just being like playing a role, which is what he claimed, of course, he's playing a role. But then later on, we found out gradually, it wasn't a role. I mean, it wasn't. I mean, he was being played. He wasn't playing the role, he was being played. This dynamic of wanting to be prime creator was playing this role. And just putting it on him, putting it on Frank Jones, saying that he was the one that was playing it. He wasn't playing it at all. He was just a stagehand. He was just a stagehand being played, claiming that he was the one doing the playing. None of it was true. He wasn't God, you see. God doesn't appear in that way here in this world, really. God sends aspects of the sonship into the world to witness to God's plan of salvation. But God, the prime creator, doesn't come into the world. Does not. Jesus was not the prime creator. Jesus was the Son of God. He tried to be adamant about that, and people still insist that he was the prime creator. God the prime creator. It's not true. There's a Trinity, God the Prime Creator, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus was God the Son. And under my mom was God the Son. See, there are aspects of the sonship, which is one with the prime creator, but it did not create the prime creator. It's an extension of the prime creator. So Frank Jones was not God. He should not have been asking people to worship him, you see. That was the dynamic of wanting to be prime creator. That's the quote-unquote ego. That is the Antichrist. That is what gets in the way. That is what causes us to doubt intelligent deference, which means we don't get the right spiritual mentoring we need, which means we get vulnerable to entertainment, which means you get vulnerable to being sucked into the Maoba's realm of entertainment. Welcome to her world, you see? Huge problem. And we're trying to overcome these obstacles right now. The Arctic air is supposed to be clearing out here pretty soon. It's been here for 5 days. Supposed to warm up tomorrow a little bit and go in a better direction big time, which is fine with me, I'm telling you. Fine with me. Wow. So there does need to be adamant advocacy, there does need to be intelligent deference. Has to be. You can't get by without it. I mean, the idea that we can throw those two aspects away and somehow be saved, is just nonsense. It's just nonsense. It's super naive. Really, our problem is we're just devastatingly naive, and we need to get over that naivete as fast as possible. How long has it went? 1:26 already? Wow. That's okay. We're hitting some high notes here. So, we can't allow Maoba to succeed in her designs. We cannot allow delay to rout us, as it were. Therefore, we have to have intelligent deference, and we have to have spiritual mentoring. We have to have those two aspects there present. So we simply have to do that and just bite the bullet and realize it might be a little awkward or uncomfortable at some point. And points because we got this kind of jittery feeling like, whoa, what is this? We're going to end up in some terrible situation, all this kind of stuff. No. Is the ego going to curse at us? Of course. The ego is going to claim, look at those lunatics, some crazy cult. Look at that, someone who thinks they're certain they know the answer. Oh, you know how that goes. Look at so-and-so. Look how that went. They're just another one of those. Of course the ego is going to, inside is going to be fuming. Because it wants to delay. We want to delay. It's not the ego. It's the dynamic of existence that's fuming. You're saying, we're scared. If we don't succeed at this plan, a contingency plan, we're going to be annihilated. So come on, everybody, don't tell us that we can't succeed. We don't want to hear that. We want to keep working on it. We want to keep working at it. And yet the futility is so intense. We're so tired of futility. What are we going to do? We don't want to let go of it. This, I'm mirroring what's going on in people's minds here. We can't let go of it. Don't dare not let go of it. But we're so tired of this futility. And what do we do? And then Maoba comes and she says, ah, my children, here I am your mother. Listen to let the entertainment begin. Let the games begin. It will be so beautiful for you. Pay attention. I will entertain you. And people say, oh, it's like, whoa, really? Really, Ma? Oh, isn't that wonderful? You're here to entertain us. Oh, and they fall under the spell like that, you see. Just delay. It's only delay. Because the impossibility of entertaining mutual exclusives is still there. And they feel the futility is still there. It's just like a narcotic. It's just a narcotic. It's just that Mahuba says she's got a better narcotic. Got more potent, more intense. She comes with a ghost pepper. She's got a ghost pepper narcotic. And of course, they're coming up with ones that are even hotter than the ghost pepper, which I didn't take. Ghost pepper's plenty hot enough, believe me. Trinidad scorpion, stuff like that. Maruga, the Maruga scorpion, all that stuff. Don't take them. If you take them, take them once, but I tell you. Don't do it. Don't do it. So, sure, there's all sorts of hot entertainment coming. But, you know, after all the strippers have taken off all their clothes a million times, where are you going to go from there? Well, you're going to start getting into all sorts of very deviant stuff, of course. Yeah, there's plenty of people here who feel perfectly comfortable with all that stuff, which is why we've had this massive push toward a deviant society going on for quite some time, for the last 40 years, really. Trying to enculturate everybody, saying, oh, this is great, this is great, this is good. And of course, meting out token punishment to certain types of deviancy, but obscuring the tide. Scaring the tide. So the entertainment can get very nasty. Very, very nasty. And we don't realize it. And again, the way everything's done, it's a narcotic. Let's be totally honest, it's absolutely a narcotic. Entertainment is a narcotic. And It includes all the subsets of narcotics. I mean, people have been trained to, use lights, all sorts of lighting, all sorts of, strobe lights. You go to clubs, all the clubbing stuff has been going on. The sound, all the pulsing of sound, there's all sorts of playing with electronic sounds, electronic lighting patterns, all the different patterns of light. All the different costumes, all the different drugs that are ingested, all the designer drugs that have been coming out, all the ethnogens, all the organic type of drugs that have been used, combinations, all that, and then all the deviant sexual, polymorphous type of sexuality. There's just everyone is included in your, you're like complete. All-inclusive sexuality, as it were. It's just absolutely nuts. All this stuff is just an intense narcotic to try to get rid of that feeling of futility, so you don't recognize that you need to make a choice between truth and lies. You need to make a choice. That's the only way. You don't want to recognize it. You're afraid, oh, we'll be annihilated if we don't get this contingency plan solved. No, you will not be annihilated, because reality can never be changed. But you won't realize that unless you get spiritual mentoring. Because, coming out of that narcotic that Mahuba is providing you, Mahuba. We've been in that. People have been through cycling through that, and you're coming out of that, and you are just like narcoticized, extremely narcoticized. I mean, the 60s, people say if you survived the 60s, you weren't there. And the same thing about the 70s and the 80s, you weren't there, right? What do this big star musician say? That half of her friends died. They didn't make it through. Half. Dead. So, entertainment business kills. It kills. The drug pushers kills. Kills them. Absolutely kills them. Entertainment business, they're just drug pushers. That's all they are. It's all the narcotic. So you don't realize you have to make a choice. That's all that it's about. All the distractions are simply so you don't see that you have to make a choice. That's nothing more than that. And when you see there is no ego, you realize there's no one to bargain with. You have to make a choice. It's all to distract you away from that. to dull the pain of futility. So you don't look at it and say, well, why do I feel futile? What's going on? And you realize, wait a minute, I'm trying to entertain mutual exclusives and that doesn't work. I have to make a choice. But that doesn't lead to futility. It leads to saying, oh, wow, there is a way out of futility. So you see, you think it makes you more depressed. It does not. It makes you less depressed because you realize there is a way out and you have these spiritual mentors who have done it. And you say, well, I know I can do it. I know I will do it eventually. So I don't feel, I know I'm going to be free of this futility for sure. But not through entertainment, not through narcotics, not through narcoticizing yourself, through entertainment and all its allied octopus arms. Entertainment is an octopus. It really is. Entertainment is an octopus. Octopussy, as it were. And it's got all its arms around you. Octopussy has all her arms around you. Maoba is the octopussy who has her all her arms around the world. And is pulling them all into this beak, you know, this maw, M-A-W, which means this destroying mouth to crunch everybody up to pieces, actually. Because that's Maoba's entertainment, is destruction, is death. That's what those who are being narcoticized don't realize. They just want to get rid of that feeling of futility. They don't realize they're being led down the primrose path to death, to being torn to pieces, really, which is of course what the Romans did. They like to sit around and watch people be torn to pieces, hacked to pieces. They thought that was entertainment. They thought it was their salvation from this ennui that they had. And of course Christian says, hey, that's not the way. And Romans says, oh, you're crazy. You're some kind of crazy cult. You gotta live underground in the catacombs. And they didn't accept it until Charlemagne had a victory under the banner, had a dream, and flew the banner of the cross, and his army was able to hack the other army to pieces. And he said, hey, wow, this Christianity is great. I can hack, I'm more successful at hacking people to pieces. My soldiers aren't frightened. And so then he officially said, okay, Christianity is the religion now of Rome, because it enabled us to hack our enemies to pieces better. But that's not the message of Christianity at all. It's gotten distorted. But it spread through pagan Europe because people somehow gave them this feeling like a lack of fear of death, and they became more successful in battle, more fearless in battle. They became expert hackers, as it were. And so the kings say, hey, wait a minute, Charlemagne, you know, the kings they're flying this cross as their battle flag. They're winning all these victories. Their soldiers are like fearless. They don't fear death at all. In fact, they think death is their salvation. So you get a religion that tells you that death is your salvation. And what more does a general want than that, you see? Christianity never said death is your salvation. I mean, Jesus never taught that. The Christianity that we have passed down is not what Jesus taught. It's really the opposite of it. In many facets, it's the opposite. It's exchanging hypotheticals. That's salvation. That's salvation. So, under the surface, there's been true Christianity has been percolating along under the surface, but on the surface of it, it's been a distorted teaching that's been being given out to the world by these, you know, warlords saying, hey, let's this works, let's use this and let's civilize under this banner because it's successful in destroying our enemies. And of course, again, that plays into dulling that feeling of ennui. What better way is there to dull the ennui of futility than to be in some pitched battle, crusader, you know, again, battles against the infidels one way or the other, two infidels battling each other to determine who's the real infidel by who's going to hack the other to pieces more. Of course, that's going to engage your attention, right? And you're going to temporarily forget about your ennui a little bit. And so you think, wow, this stuff is really great. And then people ultimately think, oh, well, if I just die, that's going to get rid of the ennui. No, it isn't, because the mind doesn't die when the flesh dies. The problems of the mind remain. The spirit doesn't die. spirit's choosing to want to be prime creator, that desire, it's not touched by the death of the flesh at all. So that whole desire remains, all the dynamics remain. What do you do? The ennui still remains. What do? You grab another body of flesh to engage with so you can be distracted more. Because the bodies can be very distracting. We can use bodies to be very distracting because we can keep, there's a sense of threat to the body survival constantly, and that gets our attention all the time. So, oh my gosh, all this stuff's coming. And if things get too boring, we'll either engage in all sorts of self-inflicted pain, you know, piercings and tattoos and dangerous sex and drugs and all sorts of dangerous practices with drugs and music, all this stuff. We'll engage with that. We'll do thrill sports. We'll do super dangerous sports. We'll engage in wars and battles and in domestic dramas, and all the, or if we're more passive that way, we'll watch it all on the screen. We'll watch it all on the big screen. Some people are watching this on a big screen. It's just because they're too lazy or tired or old to actually engage in it in real life. But there are people engaging in this stuff in real life all the time, and then the filmmakers make films about it, of all this, you know, stuff that's super threatening. Super threatening stuff. And then we engage in all these legal threats. So like, you know, legal stuff is very frightening, very intimidating. We're going to destroy you, you know, through the legal system. Legal system's like some massive army, very vicious, destructive army, and people are constantly engaged in these legal battles, courtroom battles, you know, all this kind of stuff. They say their life's on the line. They identify with it so they can forget this ennui, this feeling of futility that the ego's plan, and it's really not, there's no ego, so it's our plan, the plan that mind has to present to us, because we want to be prime creator. Mind has to present, say, hey, you need this contingency plan to succeed, so this presented to us, and it says, it's got to succeed, and you don't want it, and you're ready to drop it, so you got to hold on to both. don't choose, that's what we tell, don't choose a new hypothetical. Keep both simultaneously, and then that leads to this terrible feeling that we have. And then how to obscure that feeling leads to all this distraction of feeling threatened. And if we're not threatened in our lives, we'll watch television and get the sense of threat through that. We'll go to the movies, get the sense of threat of that, and then we'll sugarcoat it. If we start thinking, uh-oh, maybe I might figure out what I'm doing, then we'll throw in some sugarcoating on it. We'll get a chick flick occasionally, you know, that kind of thing. Of course, those things are all threatening too. Like, oh, you threaten my feelings. You threaten my heart. You threaten my happiness. All these, those are threats too. Those are all threats too. Different type of threats. That distracts us too. You go to a chick flick, what are you doing? You're playing on our heartstrings, right? that's to get rid of that feeling that you have of futility. Something inside you saying, hey, this isn't working. This contingency plan is not working. It's not working. That scares the heck out of us. That's that free-floating anxiety. You say, whoa, this contingency plan is not working. It's not working. What do I do? Let's go to a chick flick, or let's go to a guy flick. Let's go to a shoot 'em up flick. You know, let's go to a horrible, you know, that's amazing what they do with these movies. I don't watch movies, but I'm intelligent enough to recognize what's going on. You can see the advertising, the trailers. You it filters through, and you know that just the special effects are, and the mayhem is amazing, because we need more and more mayhem. We need more and more mayhem. We need more and more intense drama, more and more intense soap operas. Things are pretty soon, people will be tearing their clothes off and just going nuts, really going nuts. The rain is going to be severe because they need more, because it's not working. This contingency plan doesn't work. It'll never work. But they don't have the spiritual mentoring to deal with that, to choose a different hypothetical. They don't have it. So what do you, if you don't have that, you're going to go into this nut lunatic time. The world's going to be a lunatic asylum for sure coming up. And the problem is people have drifted away from spiritual mentoring because of all the false cases that we placed in our way, these obstacles of these unfit mentors, as it were. these mentors with Vita Clay who really screwed up and got everyone to kind of back away from a spiritual mentoring, said, you know, whoa, I better stay away from that. Well, now they're not used to spiritual mentoring. They didn't get it. And now that this feeling of futility, realizing this contingency plan is not working, it's not going to work, desperate feeling of fleet-floating anxiety and futility and a fear of being pulled into chaos and confusion and desperate need to try and avoid that at all costs, which will pull you right into Mauba's world of entertainment and decadence and wickedness and ultimately annihilate sacrificial stuff. I mean, the sacrificial stuff that was carried out throughout the world in older times, like Mesoamerica, for instance, it was grand entertainment for everybody. It was grand entertainment. They had massive festivals going on where everybody was dressed in these most exotic costumes, you know, peacock feathers and all feathers of all the birds and just dressed up like zany characters, beings like, well, you never see anything like that. Like some carnival, super drinking of all sorts of drugs. Everybody was high, super high, and drunk as could be, and indiscriminate sexual activity of all types. Decadence was going on, and then the culmination of all this was the massive human sacrifices taking place. Now, why were they doing that? Well, ultimately, it was to distract from this feeling of futility. Exactly why they did it. There's other secondary reasons, like the reptilians needing the blood. The reptilians they need this death and destruction for them, that gives them a high. It's narcotic for them. And that distracts them from the feeling of futility. So different strokes for different folks, but it's the same underlying principle. So it serves several purposes. Because the reptilians would help organize the decadence, because they need all this stuff too. They need this distraction. It's a drug for them too, you see. They have terrible problems with ennui. All of these aspects of the dream have terrible problems with ennui, which is what I mean. Everyone requires spiritual mentoring without exception. Everyone does. So Mauba is certainly the ring, the goddess of the ring, of the circus, the goddess of entertainment. Aphrodite, Isis, whatever, all the goddesses, they're really goddesses of entertainment. Let the carnival begin, that kind of thing. And of course, the carnival builds up and builds up and builds up, and you get more and more pulled into it, and you start losing all of your sense of shame, your sense of conscience, your sense of what is right and wrong, your sense of, you just lose it all. And you get swept away, and before you know it, you're engaging in the rites of Orpheus or whatever they, you know, the ancient Bacchanalian rites where people are literally pulled to pieces. And the what do you call them, the Maenads, or those are women. The women were the ancient priestess culture. That was a whole culture of these ritualistic celebrations, which was entertainment, which was ways to calm the fears, the desperate fears that we have in existence, by those we don't want to choose. I heard something there. Anyway. Going right back to that. It's all come right back. Worship of the goddess is bowing. Bowing to the goddess of entertainment. The ringmaster. Don't do that. Don't bow to any aspect of the sonship. Any dynamic in existence. Intelligent deference. And it's got to be intelligent deference. Which you, again, don't get hyped up. There's all sorts of drugs. Don't get hyped up. Very bad. Very bad. Because you get an unreasonable expectations of yourself. Because you become conceptually very quick. And so you think you can handle it conceptually. But the entertainment that's to come, you cannot handle it conceptually. That's why I say don't drink the coffee. Don't drink the stuff that gets you hyped up. Because with that, I mean, if I drank coffee right now, I'd feel like, wow, I can do it all. I can do it all. It raises the expectation. You temporarily feel like Superman conceptually. You see? So you think, wow, I can think so fast, I should be able to handle an incredible array of stuff. One second here. I may have to stop this. Okay, I will have to stop this.